Okay, kids, we are going to go over topic 4, lesson 1, estimation today. You're going to want to take out your notebook, take some notes, as well as have your math book open. Alrighty? Now, before we begin going over what's in the book, I'd like to review a couple things about how you can round a number. Okay? So we're going to talk about some things for rounding numbers, and then practice some of those skills. The first thing you want to do is always remember to identify the place value you are rounding to. Always identify that first. And then what you want to do is look at the digit to the right of the number you are rounding. The third thing you want to do is remember that if the digit to the right is 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4, you're going to round down, okay? If the digit to the right is 5, 6, 7, 8, or 9, you're going to round up, all right? Remember, if they're talking about money, money rounds to the nearest full dollar, which is the ones place, or to the cent, which is the hundredths place. So if it says round to the full dollar or round to the dollar, you're going to round to the ones place. If it says round to the cent, you're going to round to the hundredths place. Number 4. When rounding to a decimal place, you should end saying the number on the place it is rounded to. So if it says round to the tenths, the last thing you should say is tenths. If it says round to the nearest hundredths, the last thing you should say is hundredth. All right? Now let's take a look at what's in the book. In the book, they say estimating sums and differences, meaning you're estimating addition and you're estimating subtraction. How can you estimate with decimals? To estimate means to find an approximate answer to or a solution. Then they give us an example. The 10-second barrier in the 100-meter dash was broken in the 1968 Olympics, when the winning time was 9 95 hundredths seconds. Mrs. Johnson, the gym teacher, ran the 100 meters in 14 seconds, 7 tenths of a second. About how much faster was the 1968 Olympic time than Mrs. Johnson's time? So the word that tells us to estimate is the word about, okay? And then we see that we have Mrs. Johnson's time and we have the Olympic time, okay? And what we want to do is we want to know how much faster was this time compared to Mrs. Johnson's time. So right now, you should be thinking about what operation you're going to be dealing with. And that operation would be subtraction, because you're talking about a difference. Now, use rounding to quickly estimate sums and differences. Round each number to the same place value. So one way you can round is to round to the near same place value. Okay? Round each number to the nearest whole number. So in this case, they're going to the nearest whole number. So you'll see that they're going to say 7, they're going to round 14 to 15, and they're going to round 9 up to 10. So they're just dealing with whole numbers, and then they subtract, they find the difference of 5. So the difference is about 5 seconds. So this is one way of rounding. But rounding can be done several different ways depending on how you're looking at the problem. Usually there is a more accurate way, and that's usually the way that a mathematician is going to go. So here is another way. In this case, the book is talking about front-end digits, okay? And they say use the front-end digits to make a front-end estimate, and then adjust the estimate using the remaining digits. So in this case, they took the digits that are in the front end, which is the whole number 14, and they just rounded to 14. In this case, they just said, let's go with 9, and we'll go with 9. And in this case, you can see that our estimate or difference, okay, is about 5, okay? And then they say, they give you a rationale behind it, and they simply say, since 7/10 is less than 95/100, the difference is less than 5. And that's their rationale. So in the end, the 1968 Olympic time is less than 5 seconds faster than Mrs. Johnson's time. Alright, let's take a look at some more examples, alright? Now, these notes are not in your book, so you're going to want to listen carefully to them, because one of the things that I have found is that when kids are rounding, you know, they miss problems because there's little subtleties in the rounding process that you're expected to kind of know. Again, don't get discouraged if your estimate isn't always what you want it to be compared to the mathematicians. But mathematicians, they kind of do it the most efficient way possible. All right, here we go. They want you to round the number 367 and 987 thousandths to the nearest or to the following values. Okay, so here we go. If you take 367 and 987 thousandths and round it to the nearest tens place, you're talking about rounding it to where the 6 is. So the 3 in this case is probably going to stay the same. So 6 looks at 7. 7 tells 6 to round up to 7. And then you build your number based on the numbers around it. So you'll have 3, 6 rounds to 7, 7 turns to 0, and you get rid of the decimals. Okay, so that would round to 370. The next number, the same thing they want you to round to, is to the ones place. So in this case, you're going to round to the ones place. The 7 is in the ones place. It's going to look at the 9. The 9 will tell 7 that you should round up to 8. So the 7 will round up to 8. The 6 remains the same. The 3 remains the same. And you can get rid of the decimal because you don't need it because you're working with whole numbers. Okay, going to the next one, the same number, and this time we're rounding to the nearest whole number. Well, remember, the whole number is the same as the ones place, so we're rounding again to the ones place. So, of course, if we round to the ones place, we're going to have 368, all right? 368. Then they ask us to round into the decimals. In this case, they want you to round to the nearest tenth. So the tenth is the first place value to the right of the decimal point. And 8's going to tell 9 to round up. Now, this is a tricky situation because 9 is going to round to 10. So that 9 is going to turn into a 0 because we want to say tenths at the end of our number. So 9 is going to round up, which means it's going to send a 1 over to the 7. So you put your decimal point in, and 7 is going to round up to 8. And then 6 and 3 remain the same. Notice how you say our number. We have 368 and 0 tenths. So we know that we rounded to the tenths place. The next place value we're going to round this number to is to the hundredths place. So the 8 is in the hundredths place. 8's going to look at 7. 7's going to tell 8 to round up. So 8's going to round up to 9. The 9 will stay the same because it's not changed. We put our decimal point in, and then our whole number, 367, will remain the same. So we get 367 and 99 hundredths, okay? Hundredths. Notice how it ends. Don't put a zero on there. No, 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 no. Do not put a zero on there, okay? Don't make that mistake, all right? The next one, they want us to round to the nearest dollar. Remember, when you're rounding to the nearest dollar, you are rounding to the nearest whole number or to the ones place. So in this case, we're going to go back and round it to the 7. 9 is going to tell 7 you need to round up to 8. 6 will stay the same, and 3 will stay the same, but it's dollars amount, so we're going to do that. Now, in this situation, you can acceptably put on the tenths and the hundredths. You can do that, but you want to make sure that you include both zeros, okay? Either include both zeros or don't include any of the zeros, all right? That's important to know when you're working with the money. So now we're going to take that number and we're going to round it to the nearest cent. Cent means you are rounding to the hundredth place. So in this case, 8 asks 7, what do? 7 tells 8 that you want to round on up to 9, and 9 remains the same. And then the 367 is the same. Now it's talking about money, so you got to put the dollar sign in there, okay? There you go. Then we're going to round to the leading digit, because you might hear somebody say, go to the leading digit. The leading digit is the digit that's in the place value that is the greatest. So hundredths or hundreds are in the greatest place value. So we're going to round to the hundredths in this situation. 6 will tell 3, round on up to 4, and then everything to the right of it to the decimal point will turn into a 0. So the leading digit estimate of this number is going to be 400, because the leading digit is the hundreds place. Alright? So that gives you some information right there to work with. Let's take a look at another set of numbers. Alright? Round the number $56.95 to the following values. Okay? Same thing here. Alright? We're going to round it to the tens place. We see that 5 is in the tens place. 5 asks 6, what do? 6 is going to tell the 5 to go up to 6, so it will become 6. This 6 will turn into a 0. And then these two digits, you can either drop them and just have $60, or you can turn them into zeros to round $56.95 to $60. If we round it to the ones place, we'll see that we're rounding it to the 6. And in this case, 9 is going to tell 6 to turn into 7. Okay? And the 5 will remain the same, so we have $57. Again, you can convert those numbers to zeros to show the change is 0. All right? So rounded to the ones place, it is $57. Or again, if they say round that dollar amount to the nearest whole number, you're rounding it to the ones place. And again, 6 will ask 9, what do? 9 will say, go on up to 7. 5 will remain the same, and you have $57 approximately. Or you can add those zeros. But remember, you got to add 2 zeros when you're talking about money. Then they ask you to round it to the tenths. If you round it to the tenths, they're talking about rounding it to the nearest dime, okay? So 9 says to 5, what do? 5 tells 9, you're going to round up. So it rounds up, but it's going to pass a 1 over to 6, which will become 7, and then the 5 will remain a 5, and so we round it, we get approximately $57, but make sure you put in your second 0 because it is money, and you rounded it to the 10th. And then they say round it to the hundredths. Well, in this case, you want to round to the 5 because that's rounding it to the nearest cent. There's nothing over here, which means you have a 0. So in this case, you're simply going to rewrite your number as 56 and 95 cents. And in that case, you got to remember that sometimes companies will actually charge you to the thousandth of a dollar. So that's why we have a rounding to the hundredths in money. In this case, they want you to round to the nearest dollar. So the nearest dollar will be the ones place. So 6 will ask 9, what do I do? 9 will say go up to 7. 5 remains the same. And again, we end up rounding to the near to the ones place, which gives us $57. And we can put zeros on it if we want. But remember to put 2 zeros on it. Then we go into the $56.95, rounded to the nearest cent. Well, the nearest cent would be the hundredths place. And again, remember, there's nothing over there, so our money, rounded to the nearest cent, will be $56.95. Okay? And the last thing we want to do is round it to the leading digit. So we have leading digit will be in the tens place. So 5 asks 6, what do I do? 6 tells 5, round on up to 6, and we're going to estimate that at $60. You can leave it at 60 or annex those zeros to show the change. Okay? So hopefully that gives you an idea of the many different ways that we might be asked to round something. Some of them are very similar, such as rounding to the ones place and rounding to the dollar, or rounding to the hundredths place and rounding to the cent. Okay? It just really depends on how somebody is saying it or asking it of you. Now we're going to have you do... Alrighty, now let's talk about another type of rounding you might encounter. And this is called lowest leading digit estimation, okay? Meaning that you round to the lowest leading digit, all right? So let's talk about what that looks like, all right? Lowest leading digit means the digit that is leading but is representing only the highest place value out of the numbers, but is the lowest leading one. So like in this case, 5 is leading 56 and 7 tenths. 4 is leading 456 and 976 thousandths. And 4 is leading 45 and 5 tenths. And 4 is leading 46. So our lowest leading digits are in the tens place. Okay? Those are our lowest leading digits. So that's what we're going to round to. So 56 is going to round to 60. 456 is going to round to the 5 because that is in the tens place and that's what we're rounding our other numbers to. So this will become 460. Then this number, 45 and 5 tenths, will round to 50 because 5 tells 4 you need to round up. And then, of course, 46 will round also. 4 will ask 6, what do I do? And 6 will say round on up. So now we can estimate these together and we see that this is 520 and this becomes 100. And when we add those together, we get 620. Okay? That's what lowest leading digit means. It means you identify the leading digit in all your numbers, and then you go with the one that is the lowest for all of the numbers, but still in the lead. All right? I want you to try a couple problems on your own. Pause the video and see if you can estimate your answer for 1 and 2. Then we'll show you how it's done. Okay, here we go. Let's see how you did. Alright, in the first problem, they take the 1 and 769 thousandths and they round it to 1 and 8 tenths. Then they take 686 thousandths and they round that to 7 tenths. When you add those together, you're going to get 2 and 5 tenths. So if you take those and you round them up together, you'll see that you're going to get, you get 15, 8 plus 7 is 15, you carry your 1, you end up with 2 and 5 tenths. For number 2, you see that they took the 20 and 45 hundredths and they rounded this very simply to 20 and 5 tenths. And when you subtract the 20 and 5 tenths, take away the 13 and 2 tenths, you'll see that you get 3, borrow, regroup, and you get 7 and 3 tenths. So the answer to this is 7 and 3 tenths. Try completing 3 and 4. They want you to round each number to the nearest whole number and estimate that answer. Pause the video and see how you do. Alright, here we go. If you look at the answers here, they want you to round it to the whole number. So this number is going to round to 1, and then 5 and 4 tenths will round to 5, because that's our whole number. And then our whole number over here, we're rounding the whole number, so it's the ones place. So this is going to round to 14, and when we add those up, we see that we have 1 plus 5 is 6, 6 plus 14 is our estimate of 20. Okay? In the next one, they have subtraction. Be careful with that. And they're rounding it to the nearest whole number, which means that this will, the 2 will remain the same, and we will end up with 72 minus, and then this is careful, be careful here, 9 is going to round up one place value, which means you regroup over the 5 to get 60. 72 take away 60 equals 12. So our estimate is 12. Alright, give these problems a try. They want you to use front-end estimation to estimate each answer. Pause the video and see how you do. Alright, here we go. With front-end estimation, this 7 and 12 hundredths becomes 7. The 2 and 501 thousandths will round to 3, because 2 asks 5 what to do, and 5 says you need to round up to 3. And then the 9 and 2 tenths will round to 9, and if we add those up, 7 plus 3 is 10, plus 9 is estimated out at 19. The next problem, okay, when we go over it, we're going to round 91 and 26 hundredths to 90, and then the 30 will round right out the 30. And so when we subtract, we end up with an estimate of 60. Alrighty, the last problem, give this a try. Pause the video and see how you do. Alrighty, here we go. Rachel is shopping and needs to buy bread, lunch meat, and pretzels to make lunch. She has a $10 bill. Will she have enough money for her purchases? Use estimation to find out whether she will have enough money or not. Explain your reasoning. Well, if we look over here, we see that bread is $1.82. We see that lunch meat is $4.93. And pretzels cost $2.03. All right? And so what we need to do is find out if that bill will come in under $10 approximately. Well, in this case, we're going to round everything to the leading digit. So the bread will round out to $2. This would become $2. And the lunch meat will round out to $5. And the pretzels will round out to $2. And so when we add up that bill, we'll see that we get approximately $9. And 10 take away 9 is going to be $1 difference. So yeah, the $10 bill, yes, she has enough. All right. Okay, hopefully this does it for you and you have a better understanding of estimation. If not, you can ask your parents for help or see the teacher. Remember, there are also other supplemental videos put into your lessons.